Our final presentation is remote sensing technology for structural health monitoring. It's given by TzuYang Yu, professor of civil and environmental engineering at the University of Massachusetts Lowell. He received his PhD from MIT in the field of structural engineering and material, and specialized in remote electromagnetic imaging on concrete structure. In 2008, he was awarded the ASNT Fellowship Award. Also, he has several awards. He also received a 2017 Donald Leach Award for the Civil and Environmental Engineering Department at University of UMass Lowell for his outstanding research performance. And he has been funded by many, many, many federal and state agencies. So thank you.
Thank you, Binka, for the very kind introduction. Hey. This way. Okay. Now, the topic of my talk is remote sensing technology for structural health monitoring. Now, I took the liberty by assuming that most people in this room already know what structural health monitoring is. So I will give you three examples on how to use remote sensing techniques for structural health monitoring. The other way around. I hold it the wrong way. Technology, eh? Okay. All right. So what is remote sensing? Remote sensing is the effort of putting sensors on a mobile platform to collect spatial information. That's what remote sensing is. Now, that's not the technology we coined in civil engineering. It's somewhere that we borrow from actually space technologies, agriculture, and earth science. So in order for civil engineers to better understand that how we should use remote sensing technologies, we should actually know the big picture first. So in order to collect the spatial information, you can see that the definition of remotes has been changing over time. Now in earth science and also in space applications, this remote means that the distance between your sensor and the surface of a structure usually is in a range of kilometers. And the platform for years have been either a satellite or an aircraft. Now, since we borrowed the technology into the civil engineering applications, we have different needs because we want to use the technology to solve the problems in civil engineering. Now you can see here, there are many different kinds of drones that we've been taking, using it for the remote sensing applications in civil engineering. So the good news is remote sensing is an area or is a discipline that being contributed by many different industries or disciplines as well. For example, the development of drones is supported by mechanical engineers, and the signal processing is supported by computer scientists. And also the imaging processing is supported by researchers from physics, chemistry, and electrical engineering. So it's a really a multidisciplinary area for remote sensing. But when we borrow the idea of remote sensing for the structural health monitoring of civil infrastructure systems, we actually had different needs. Now I'd like to direct your attention to this spectrum here. What is remote sensing? Well, there are different kinds of waves we can use. You can use mechanical waves or you can use electromagnetic waves. Now civil engineers are more familiar with mechanical waves because that's what we're being trained for. However, remote sensing, the nature of remote sensing actually can take the advantage of electromagnetic waves. What kind of electromagnetic wave are we talking about here? And this is the spectrum, perhaps is not so commonly seen by civil engineers, but we are talking about the microwaves, we're talking about the visualized, we're talking about UV, we're talking about IR. And if we go a little bit higher frequencies, you can actually use X-rays or gamma rays. So there are two parameters I like to bring it to your attention. The first one is the wavelength or frequency, which is essentially means that if you use the lower frequencies that you have a longer wavelength, your signals can actually propagate longer, can penetrate through clouds, can penetrate even through people. That's the reason why you can still take phone calls in this building, because your cell phone signal will not be blocked by the buildings. Another factor you have to take into account is the energy level. which means that if you want to go higher frequencies, you need to provide higher energy levels in order to produce that. For years, there are two different kinds of remote sensing. One is the passive, the other is active. So what is passive? Passive means that putting sensors on the platform, just flying around, collecting data from the background or from the environment. Now, what is active? Active means that I have the source of the energy, which could be a laser, could be a radar waves. And I'm generating the signal from the sensor platform and collecting the reflection of the sense of that signal. So that's active. Now, there's always pros and cons between passive and also active remote sensing technologies. But in general, passive remote sensing usually allows you to collect more broadband signals because that's coming from the background. And the signal strength is usually much weaker. For active remote sensing, your signal is usually more narrow banded. For example, you can only choose certain frequencies. For spatial remote sensing, they usually use megahertz electromagnetic waves. So it depends on our needs. Listed here, you can see there are different kind of type of applications. There's a ground penetrating radar. There's a synthetic aperture radar. There's a terrestrial radar interferometry. And also there's a laser, there's a visual inspection, 3D photogrammetry, so on and so forth. Now, here comes the second part of my presentation. I will show you three different examples, how we use remote sensing techniques for structural health monitoring. And by introducing the three different examples, you probably will understand a little bit better what structural health monitoring is. The first example is the use of laser Doppler vibrometry on extracting the structural properties of a railroad bridge under the application of a moving train. So this is a bridge actually located at the border between New Hampshire and Maine. It's more than 80-year-old railroad bridge. It was owned by Pan Am. I think now it's owned by CSX. And UMass has been monitoring this bridge since the late 2019. And every year we go back to the bridge, we put out the sensor underneath. Actually, you already heard from the Professor Wayne's talk on having the distributed sensor on this bridge. We also use laser vibrometers to monitor the vibration of this bridge. Showing here, you can see the location of this laser vibrometer is of course very portable. And with the laser beam, you can see that we can project laser beam at the midspan and then directly measure the vibration of the bridge upon loading of a moving Amtrak train. So what can we get from that information? Suppose you can measure displacement, dynamic displacement, velocity, and acceleration all in one unit. And what can we understand from the data? Well, first of all, if you have the dynamic displacement measurement, which is the time displacement information, you can even first to know that what is the vibration, what's the background of the signal. So by monitoring the background, we know that there's a 55.69 hertz vibration from the background without any train loading. So where does the signal come from? The signal actually is from the adjacent river. So there's a constant vibration of the signal coming from the river. And now if we capture the vibration of the train, you can see there's a two very strong vibration signal response from the two locomotives and four passenger trains very clearly captured in this result. Now, by looking at the force vibration, you can get the loading frequency. And by the end of the tail of this response, you have the free vibration, which you can extract structural properties such as stiffness, damping, and mass. So by going through this calculation, we actually can calculate the speed of the train, even so that we have no idea what the speed is. And we learned that the speed of the train was about 113 miles per hour. That is within the limit of the information posted by the Amtrak, which tells us that our calculation is correct. And then we use the force vibration to calculate the damping and calculate the stiffness. So these are the parameters we can use for structural health monitoring, which means that you constantly monitor the change of the stiffness and damping in order to quantify the condition of the structural health. The second example is the use of ground penetrating radar. In this case, we have graduate students using a portable ground penetrating radar to remotely interrogate two wooden cross ties. And with the support by the CSX transportation, we have the specimens, we conduct the experiments on campus. And by looking at the information which is generated by the GPR, we have the spatial information, which that means that you can see through the cross tie. And that gives you the content of this of these two cross ties for earlier condition assessment. The third application that we have at UMass is what we call synthetic aperture radar. It is a technology by integrating the spatial information to improve the image resolution. So in this case, we have this synthetic aperture radar sensor scanning through a reinforced concrete specimen, which was cracked by a four-point bending. So we generate a four-point bend, the artificial cracks by the four-point bending, and use this face this cracked surface for the radar, and then use the radar to interrogate it. The idea is to know that what is the, we know there's not just one crack, there's a distributed cracks. So the purpose is, can we use it to detect the distribution of cracks? And the result is that we can actually see the difference. And there are lots of things we can extract from this information. So my closing remark is this. Remote sensing technologies have lots of benefits. We heard this from the keynote speakers this morning, and also you see the applications from different presenters today. But what I'd like to share with this particular audience is that there's still a long way to go. Even so, that technologies have advanced to the level that civil engineers working in transportation industry can actually leverage these technological advances, but we have our own problems to solve. At the end, realistically speaking, nothing can be done without the help of graduate students. So I'd like to take the opportunity to acknowledge my four graduate students working here, Qishang, Sanjana, and Kusha, and well, actually that's a typo that should be recent. The two of them are sitting in the audience. With that, thank you very much for your time.